Thank you. Thank you so much, Senator Brown. Thank you to everyone here at Mertes Taylor for welcoming us so warmly. I know any event requires a lot of work, so I just am so grateful to the leadership here and to the staff who has welcomed us so warmly today and who will clean up after we are all gone. So really, thank you so much, particularly given it's President's Day and a holiday. I'm so grateful for some of you who came into work today who I know didn't have to enable us to get together this afternoon. I want to thank the senator again for that incredibly, I think, apt introduction about what's really at stake in this election. I want to thank your congresswoman, whom I am such a big fan of, and I think we're all really lucky to have in the U.S. House. I was saying to Congresswoman Fudge earlier that her work, particularly on early childhood education, means so much to me. It's work that my mother first engaged in more than 40 years ago and is one of the reasons that she is running for president. You heard from the senator why he thinks this is such an important election. I want to share a little bit about why I think this is such an important election and then open it up to your questions, to your comments, anything that may be on your heart or on your mind as you think about this election. I also am very open to parenting advice, and we're going to welcome our second child this summer. So for those of you who want to offer advice, I'm always really welcome and appreciative of that. I think this is the most important presidential election of my lifetime. And I feel that way for two fundamental and admittedly interconnected reasons. The first is that this is the first presidential election I will vote in as a mom. And I didn't know I could care any more about politics or who was running for holding public office until I was lucky enough, blessed enough to become a parent. I grew up going to events like this. That's probably not a surprise. And I don't really have a time in my life that I remember where I wasn't going to organizing events or political rallies for my dad, but also for whoever my family was supporting who was running for mayor, city manager of Little Rock, who was running to represent Arkansas in the House or the Senate, and of course who is the Democratic standard bearer for president. And yet now that I'm a mother, I have a 16-month-old daughter, Charlotte, at home. I very much hope we'll be able to welcome her little sister or little brother as a healthy, happy, giggly little person this summer. This election just feels that much more urgent to me, because whomever we elect as our next president will be stewarding our country and our world and have such a profound impact on... yes, okay, sit down, pregnant lady. Yes, Congresswoman. Thank you. I appreciate that. So I just feel such an intensity about this election because I feel a different level of responsibility now that I'm a parent. And the second reason I think this election is so important was, I think, really well captured in what the senator spoke about. We have to protect the progress that President Obama has made and build on that progress. We cannot afford to go backward. And I think the Supreme Court question really highlights this, although it's also such a broader area. I think we have to have a president who knows when to stand her ground, but we also do have to have a president who knows when to find common ground. Because even in the most optimistic predictions, admittedly optimistic from a Democratic standpoint, you know, Congresswoman Fudge is not going to be able to be the chairperson that she deserves to be and we want her to be, given the Republicans dominate Congress and are expected to continue to dominate Congress. So we're going to work really hard to empower her and her Democratic colleagues, but that's a longer road. So we need someone who is a visionary but also a bridge builder in the way that President Obama so effectively has led us. And I think my mother's record uniquely attests to someone who's able to do that. So as a very proud daughter, but also now as a mother who feels such urgency, I'd like to give just a few examples. As my mom jokes, before it was called Obamacare, it was called Hillary Care. And I remember in 93 and 94, my mom fought really hard for universal health care. And that didn't work out, rather famously or infamously, I guess, depending on your perspective. And she could have said, well, that didn't work out. We'll try again another day. But that's not what she said. She said, we can't let the perfect be the enemy of the good. I think we can still get universal coverage for low-income kids. And she spent the next 3 years building a bipartisan coalition, which she had to do, because then, like today, the Republicans controlled Congress and passed the Children's Health Insurance Program, which today insures more than 8 million low-income American kids, including tens of thousands here in Ohio. And to me, that's what progress really looks like, when we actually make progress and make a real difference in the lives of our most vulnerable and our most precious Americans, our children. And early childhood education, something I already acknowledge is one of the reasons I'm such a fan of your congresswoman, is something that my mom has been working on her whole life, partly because her mother was born to unwed teenage parents, was abandoned multiple times when she was growing up, had to start working to support herself when she was not quite 14. And yet what made such a difference in her life was having teachers, teachers at church, teachers in school, and counselors who really believed in her. And knowing her mother's story is part of what motivated my mother to start the first early childhood education program in Arkansas, a program called HIPPE, so a pretty memorable name, that now exists in 26 states across our country. It's part of what motivated her when she was First Lady to work with Congressman DeLay, not exactly of the same political persuasion as the three of us sitting up here this afternoon, to radically change the inhibitions and restrictions on adopting kids out of the foster care system. There are now more than 80% more kids adopted out of the foster care system than there were 15 years ago because of the work that my mom did with Congressman DeLay. When she was in the Senate, doubling the funding for Head Start and early Head Start programs, that to me is what real progress looks like. And there's been a lot of attention now paid in this election to health care. And I think it is an important distinction between her and her opponent. When we get the newest numbers on enrollment from January, from the period that just ended for the whole year, we'll probably be about 91 or 92% covered in our country. That's never been true. And that wouldn't be possible without President Obama's leadership on the Affordable Care Act. And as the Congresswoman and the Senator know even better than I do, the Republicans work to tear that down every day, practically. The Republicans have voted 63 times to repeal the Affordable Care Act. And President Obama has stood firm, protected it, defended it. If we open any space, I worry we're going to go backward. And yet, if we're really at 91, 92% coverage, as my mom says, it's a lot easier than to get to 100% coverage and to lower out-of-pocket expenses than to start all over again. Yes, ma'am. And something my mom has been working on since 1993 is to give Medicare the power to negotiate with drug companies so that Medicare drug prices go down dramatically. And that's something that has been achieved now for the VA, because even the Republicans had a hard time denying our veterans lowered pharmaceutical prices. But it's something where there's starting to be at least possibility for Medicare. And that's good even for those of us that aren't on Medicare, because it's hard for the drug companies to justify charging one price to someone on Medicare and then charging me, or if my daughter, God forbid, gets sick, you know, something that costs 300 or 3,000 times as much. So we know the work is unfinished, but we have to finish the work of President Obama, not go backward and certainly not start over. So there is so much at stake in this election, and I think we are continually reminded of that, not only with the tragic passing of Justice Scalia, because anyone who dies tragically and leaves so many children and grandchildren, of course that's a tragedy for his family. it does open, though, the question of what will the Supreme Court look like in the future? And what type of court do we want to have to protect our values, but also to continue to help us move forward together? But I would argue we had another sobering reminder from the Republican debate on Saturday night, in which, again, the sexism and the racism and the anti-Islamic rhetoric and the anti-immigrant rhetoric, and that's just not the world that I want my children to grow up in. So we have to find common ground, absolutely, when we're trying to move forward, but we also have to have a president who knows when to stand up to hate speech and stand up to bigotry and discrimination whenever and wherever it arises, because on some things there can never be a compromise. So I am clearly a very proud daughter, and I make no apology about that. I certainly hope that my children feel the same way about me someday as I feel about both my parents. I'm really grateful every day to God for my parents and also for my grandparents, none of whom are with us any longer, sadly. And yet I sit here, thanks to the Congresswoman sitting here, not standing here, sitting here today mainly now as a mother myself. And I feel such an intensity about this election and continuing to move forward and to build on the progress that President Obama has made, because it is personal in a way that it's never been for me before, because I'm now a mother. And so I just am grateful, so deeply, deeply grateful that you chose to spend time with me today, that so many of you are already supporting my mom. And yet I really, though, do want to hear any and all questions that may be on your hearts or on your minds as you think about this election. And also, I'm very grateful to be surrounded by the Congresswoman and the Senator. So if I don't know the answer, I'm sure they will. Yes, ma'am, you were the first person to raise your hand in the gray sweatshirt. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Jean Janeiro, I won't take up all your time because you're probably going to have enough time.
Can we put a microphone right behind?
And ma'am, will you please tell me your name?
Hi, my name is Barbara Harris, and I don't want to take up all your time, but it's the burning thing on me is about the health care. I'm a retiree from Metropolitan Hospital, 31 years. I've been married 50 years. I have 5 children, 23 grandchildren, 6 great-grandchildren, and I am still working with the Jewish Foundation with special need children, and I also work with, I'm a surrogate parent. But my question is, and it goes straight back, we work so hard. I'm 73 years old. We work so hard to get insurance, and then when you go now, since this year, they redid it, crazy, but they redid it. So when I go get my medicine, it's $40. Well, two was $80 for just one set. The other set was another $80. So if you're on fixed income, they're fixing it for us already. So we can't afford either to eat or either to go ahead and pay your medicine bill and go to the doctor. So all they had to do was just left it stay. Like Obama, President Obama is excellent. He did the Obamacare. I'm sorry.
You know, just go ahead. Just wrap
it up. Like I say, he's wonderful. But I just wanted to share that we need more information, not information, but things going on with the medicine and the medical and the prescriptions, that we will be able to eat and take medicine. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. And no one should ever have to make that that choice. I mean, no one should ever have to choose between medicine and food. I mean, that should not be a choice that anyone in our country should ever have to make. It's one of the reasons why my mom has been working on prescription drug costs for so long. And actually, in 93 and 94, probably the most significant special interest that defeated healthcare reform then really was the pharmaceutical industry, because they knew how serious she was about empowering Medicare to negotiate with them and using the purchasing power of Medicare, of capping the annual amount that any one drug company could charge for any one drug to any one person, which goes directly to your question, ma'am. Although you also raise a larger question that relates to equal pay for equal work. One of the reasons equal pay for equal work is so important, beyond the fact that women deserve to be paid equally to men for our equal efforts, is that when women are not paid equally over a lifetime, that reflects in Social Security payments. So equal pay for equal work is not only a women's rights issue, it's certainly also a family rights issue to ensure that women are able to contribute what we can and what we want to our family, but it also is an issue that directly reflects our Social Security population. So it is both about getting drug costs down, but also about ensuring that every woman is equally valued and validated for all the work over her lifetime, even when she's no longer working. So thank you. Yes, ma'am, in the purple.
Good afternoon. My name is Ernestine Rush. I'm a 30-year retiree from RTA. Chelsea, what I'd like to suggest to your mother is, because I'm following the debates on TV since they started, is she should give the United States more of her qualifications. I know she's overqualified, but if the young people don't know how qualified she is, then they will not vote for her. So she should start way down there when she was 19 from the very beginning and tell them her history all the way up through now, and they'll be more inclined to want to vote for her because she's
thank
more
you so
overqualified
much.
From Bernie Sanders.
Thank you. Well, I certainly agree that my mother's very qualified. Sure, wait, hold on. The senator wants to say something, and then I'll say something.
Thank you. I'll just say one sentence, Ms. Rush. Mrs. Rush, thank you. Hillary Clinton is the best qualified person to run in either party for President of the United States in my lifetime. I mean, there's nobody as qualified. You know, nobody is qualified that's run for president in the last 50 years as Hillary Clinton is, period. And that's something that we need. Well, Bill wasn't as qualified when he ran as Hillary is now. I want to see her answer to that. Was Bill more qualified or Hillary?
No. No, I mean, I well, thank you, ma'am. I mean, I agree. I mean, my mom, her first job when she got out of law school was to work for the Children's Defense Fund. And when she worked for the Children's Defense Fund, she worked on lots of different things, but the three things she worked the most intensely on were, one, she was part of an effort to figure out why so many kids weren't in school in the early 1970s. And what she and her team found was that a lot of kids weren't in school because they had physical and mental disabilities. And some of those kids who had mental and physical disabilities had been poisoned by lead. So Flint is very personal for my mom because she's been working on this for more than 40 years. Second thing that she did was she actually spent a lot of time in South Carolina trying to get young African-American men who were in the adult prison system back into the juvenile system where they belonged and get them the education that they had a constitutional right to. And the third thing she did was working in Alabama to expose segregation academies, which were the illegal rerouting of public funds to finance all white schools, even 20 years after Brown v. Board of Education. So, you know, every issue that I admit I think is most important, whether I'm thinking about women's rights or equal opportunity, my mother's been working on for longer than I've been alive. So I think that should matter. Well, and yes, ma'am, and you should tell everyone too, please. Great. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. In the green shirt.
Okay, so my question is, how do you feel about discrimination on LGBT and your mother's viewpoints?
I think discrimination against the LGBT community is part of our unfinished business in the 21st century. And I think this is an area where it's important both to know what policies we need, but also how to make the government work. So what do I mean by that? Well, there are still 31 states in our country where it is legal to discriminate against someone on the basis of their gender identity or sexual orientation. So it is legal to discriminate against someone in education or employment or in housing, which is partly why we need stronger federal legislation, which my mom has been a big supporter of, as have the two people sitting on either side of me. It's also why the Supreme Court appointment is so important, and it's partly why it matters to me that whenever my mom has been talking about the Supreme Court, even before the tragedy of Justice Scalia's sudden passing, she always talks about a woman's right to choose and LGBT rights, because clearly these are issues that will, again, come before the Supreme Court. But I think the point about how to make government work really matters. When my mom was Secretary of State, she did two things that I think really demonstrate that. One, she created the first ambassador-level position for someone to just focus on women's rights. And so that sent a clear signal that how countries treated women and girls mattered to the United States. And she talked about women and girls everywhere she went, even in places like Saudi Arabia that don't exactly give women the same rights that we have here. And she made it every embassy's responsibility to know what was happening in those countries around women and girls. Secretary Kerry has continued all of that. She did the same with LGBT rights. She created a job where it's someone's responsibility at the State Department to know how the LGBT community is being treated or LGBT activists are being treated in every country, to fast track asylum applications for LGBT activists and individuals who are being persecuted or even prosecuted in those countries, to again expect every embassy around the world to know what's happening to the LGBT community in the countries where they're posted. That's really important that it continued under Secretary Kerry as well, because it'll be harder for whomever comes next to dismantle that. So it's important to know how to not only assert and protect our values, I think, when you're in office, but also how to protect and continue to defend our values if you're not in office. Because I certainly always hope we have a Democratic president, a Democratic Secretary of State. But if we don't, I feel a lot better knowing that my mom created a State Department where those are more likely to be true and more likely that work is getting done on behalf of people who still remain far too vulnerable and far too often persecuted around the world, regardless of who the Secretary of State is. Hold on, and the Congressman wants to say something.